Thank you. Welcome to today's Council on Foreign Relations meeting on the state of global governance in the era of COVID-19, a conversation with Richard Haass and the Council of Councils. I'm Corey Shockey, Director of Foreign and Defense Policy at the American Enterprise Institute, and I have the pleasure of presiding over today's discussion. I'm joined by Richard Haass, the President of the Council on Foreign Relations, and Nathalie Tocci, the Director of the Institute of International Affairs in Italy. Unfortunately, Chen Dongxiao, President of the Shanghai Institutes for International Studies in China, is unable to be with us this morning as he's taken ill. But we have the pleasure of more time with Dr. Tocci and Dr. Haass. Nathalie Tocci holds a PhD from the LSE, was advisor to the EU Foreign Policy Chief, and leads the Institute for International Affairs in Rome. Dr. Haass holds a PhD from Oxford, where he was a Rhodes Scholar, has been ambassador to Northern Ireland, the director of policy planning, and the author of some 14 or 15 books, a level of productivity all of us should hold against him. So let me start by asking you both, what was the state of global governance before COVID-19, and how has COVID affected it? Richard, let's start with you.
Well, thank you, Corey. Great to be here with you and Nathalie. To make an important question, or to summarize the answer to make it short, the state of global governance before COVID-19, say a year and a half ago, was poor. And 18 months later, the state of global governance continues to be poor. This is true in the realm of global health, and it's true in virtually any and every realm. There's a large gap between the scale of global challenges and the scale of the collective response. Doesn't mean there haven't been some small movements, say on climate, at least the statements or intentions of various parties looks a bit more positive. We'll see what the performance is. But if we were going to go around from challenge to challenge, issue to issue, institution to institution, the bottom line is the inadequacy of global arrangements. And that reflects, I think, a certain lack of ideas, institutional failure to either keep up or adapt. In some cases, there's not even institutions as in cyber. And more than anything, Corey, I think it simply reflects a lack of collective thinking. The most overused phrase in our business might well be international community. And the deep, dark secret is that there isn't much international community, which explains why global governance is the way it is and the way it isn't.
Nathalie, what would you add to that, my friend?
I mean, I would agree with Richard. I mean, the state was poor and it was clear across the board. It was poor for the fact that, you know, I mean, the main cause of it was this, and, you know, we've known this for the last decade or so, that power in the international system had been shifting. Global governance had been constructed on a particular configuration of power. I mean, if we're thinking particularly of the post-Cold War period, it had been constructed, if you like, on the premise of US hegemony. And as power started being sort of shifted and redistributed, and also as it started changing in nature, in the sense that power started residing less in subjects and more in the flows between, if you like, different subjects and networks, if you like. In a sense, global governance, there started being an increasing mismatch between, if you like, power as the underlying premise, if you like, of a particular governance architecture and what that governance architecture was all about. So even before COVID, we had a situation whereby, well, of course, there was a particular sort of moment of a particular moment in US history where, if you like, the actor that had really been at the heart of that architecture started sort of, you know, quite explicitly working against it. So there was obviously the sort of the Trump parenthesis in all of this. But then you had a series of other actors that perhaps talked sort of global governance and multilateralism, but acted against it. And obviously here I'm thinking, you know, mainly China, mainly Russia. And so you had others like Europeans that alone simply, you know, particularly without the United States, could not really move forward. So I think that was the picture prior to COVID. We then, and I would agree with Richard in the sense, I would agree, but then I think there's a story of shadows and also a story of potential light, if you like, from the pandemic and what this has taught us. Because I think certainly that the shadow lies in the fact that now we know that the international system has crystallized not simply in a sort of more multipolar direction, which is basically what the debate between the global financial crisis and COVID was all about, but overlaying, if you like, that multipolar system is in a sense a new form of bipolarity, which is really a bipolarity about values. And that inevitably complicates further the quest for global governance, because at the end of the day, if you end up with an international system, where in a way which in this respect does echo back, if you like, to the Cold War, but where there is a fundamental divergence of values, if you like, it becomes, sort of difficult to find or to sort of simply concentrate on the policy solutions across different policy areas. So that inevitably has complicated the quest for global governance. At the same time, I do think that the pandemic has also encouraged, if you like, the search for global governance solutions, because it has made even more obvious that the main challenges of the 21st century are transnational in nature. And I don't think anyone really disputes that anymore. I mean, no one really disputes that we're talking about digital climate, demography in different shapes and forms, and public health, all of which are by definition, if you like, transnational in nature. So at least I think, you know, as a sort of look at the positive in all this, that holds the seeds for a greater demand, if you like, for global governance than what we've seen sort of prior to the pandemic.
Richard, you had such interesting expressions playing across your face as Nathalie was talking. I'd love to hear your reaction to her analysis.
Probably why I don't play poker for a living. Let's just take the immediate challenge that the world is living with, or in many cases dying from, which is COVID. And let's look at global health. This is it's a perfect case study of the inadequacy of global governance. The World Health Organization, which is the principal organization in the world entrusted with dealing with global health challenges, has clearly failed. The world was not prepared for the pandemic in many cases. Its ability to monitor outbreaks of dangerous pathogens of diseases in individual countries is obviously limited. Look at the ongoing dance for 18 months now between the WHO and China. We still do not fully understand what happened, and there's growing belief, I would say, not consensus belief, that this disease started in a laboratory in Wuhan rather than as naturally occurring in markets because of animal to human transmission. But we can't know for sure, because a sovereign state that happens to be a major power, which is blocking the World Health Organization from performing its functions. We're seeing wildly uneven performance around the world in terms of dealing with COVID. Again, what matters is not global governance, but national performance. And then when it comes to, you know, some of the principal treatments, equipment arrangements were inadequate in terms of sharing. They were ad hoc. Most important, look at the vaccine issue. Here we are at a situation where, say, the United States has an excess of supply over demand when it comes to vaccine. Much of the world has an excess of demand over supply, and we don't have yet the mechanisms in place, or if we have the mechanisms, they're not working either to generate sufficient funds or sufficient vaccines. There's not yet consensus on how to reform the World Health Organization so the world is better positioned for the inevitable next pandemic. So I'm not saying, you know, we won't get finally on top of the vaccine issue. Hopefully we will. I'm not saying the world health machinery won't improve. Hopefully it will. All I'm saying is, you know, Corey, you asked, how is the world doing on its most pressing challenge right now? You have to give it failing marks. And my hunch is far, far more people have died around the world than the official numbers suggest. Even the counting is off, because why? The counting is national. And many countries refuse to count honestly because it's politically embarrassing for the leadership, where they don't have the capacity to count accurately because they simply don't have the national capacity. So again, global governance is a function in many ways of national capability and national willingness to collaborate. And in global health, this is just one area. We could talk about any number of areas. Clearly, the world comes up short at a critical time and look at the consequences.
So before I go back to Nathalie, let me press you a little bit, Richard, on what global governance should look like to address pandemics. What would you like to see that we don't have in global governance that would help the so-called international community manage transnational crises like this?
No, it's a great question. In part, my answer is influenced or informed by a task force that the council sponsored that came out about 6 months ago on this issue. We'd obviously want to have in place better national capabilities. And that means that we would want the world to do a better job of rating and then improving national capabilities. Every country should have a qualified equivalent of the Centers for Disease Control. So we want to build up national capabilities. We'd want the world to pitch in with money or technology where countries need it. Even before this broke out, the international health regulations weren't being met by the lion's share of the world's countries. So that's one thing. Second of all, we'd want to have all sorts of stocks and arrangements for sharing critical supplies. Thirdly, we'd want to have an independent mechanism for blowing the whistle. Host governments should not have power over the ability to alert the world that something bad has happened. And that's the case now. And lots of countries don't want to alert the world because they're worried the tourists will stop coming. It'll again be politically awkward for a government. Investment will stop. Business travel will stop. We need something that countries of the world have to either cooperate with, or there's consequences. Might be sanctions. It might be that this independent agency says no one in their right mind should step foot in country X because we have reason to believe that XYZ has happened and they have not opened themselves up to scrutiny. So there ought to be immediate sanctions. Again, it's part of my larger argument, Corey, that with sovereignty has to come obligations as well as rights. And countries just focus on their rights. Well, we have the right to, you know, not let in the World Health Organization. Well, no, they have obligations, not just, you know, to their own citizens, but to the world. And then lastly, the whole vaccine mechanism. We would need to have a much greater global capacity to produce vaccines, whether it's extra factories, whether it's technology sharing arrangements under, you know, patent licensing, whether, again, it's simply the countries of actual supply. And so forth. So we would need to, and guess what? We're going to have a chance to get this right. Because the one thing we know is COVID-19 ain't the last. For all I know, there'll be COVID-22 or COVID-24 or something else. Mm-hmm. So we have a chance to get it right. There's lots of reports that are coming out basically saying on pandemic preparedness. But I think, again, it means changing in some ways the power balance between individual countries and the world. Introducing obligations as well as rights to sovereign countries, including but not limited to China, and then building up stronger global machinery for both sounding the alarm and responding to it.
Nathalie, the area of the world that has done the best in advancing multilateral governance is Europe, through the European Union. How has the EU done in managing the pandemic, and what lessons can we take for global governance from what the EU has succeeded and failed at in the pandemic?
I mean, I think sort of internally, the EU has actually done quite well. And it's going to sound a little bit odd that I put it in these terms. But I mean, if you think about it, we come from over a decade of sort of, you know, going from one existential crisis to the other. And the sort of constant between these, I mean, if we just take, you know, the sovereign debt crisis and then the so-called migration crisis, the one thing that connects these two and what made them existential in nature is that what went missing is the magic word that is really at the heart of European integration, which is solidarity. Or at least there was a perceived sense of a lack of solidarity, which is something which was, in a sense, rediscovered over the course of this pandemic. I mean, not out of altruism or generosity, but out of, which is then connected to the broader point about global governance, out of a sense of there is no alternative. I mean, we can only get out of this, we can only exit the crisis, be it the health dimension of it, and even more so, the economic repercussions, if we do it together. And I mean, in all honesty, had there been a lack of solidarity, as it appeared to be the case in the very first months, if you like, of the pandemic, it probably would have been a crisis too many for the European Union to survive. But it didn't happen. And I think so internally, what the EU did was, you know, through its program, Next Generation EU, it not only allowed itself the opportunity to pick up, if you like, the process left basically sort of, you know, collecting dust on a shelf, basically, you know, the process of developing, if you like, European integration, particularly as far as moving towards a fiscal union is concerned. So that, if you like, program is now, at least has an opportunity to restart now, but it also found, refound a story to tell. It's a green story, it's a digital story. So as far as, if you like, EU internally, I would say, well, you know, obviously the proof is going to be in the pudding, but relatively good marks. Where I'm far more critical is in the EU in the world story. Now, in all honesty, this has been a moment of kind of navel gazing for us all, which is also part of the reason why global governance has suffered so much. You know, I mean, it has been, and this is the broader story about vaccine nationalism, etc. But in all honesty, what we had seen in that period, if you like, I would say that sort of more or less 2014 to 2018, 2019, in which indeed the European Union couldn't agree on Eurozone reform, couldn't agree on finding a common solution to migration, but all of a sudden it kind of found this sense of, you know, we've got to be more present on a global scale. We've got to take more responsibility also as far as security and defense are concerned. Now, that has gone. I mean, that momentum has disappeared altogether. So in a sense, this is a story about a European Union that refines, in a sense, more of an internal narrative through that sense of solidarity, whereby it self-understands itself as a community of fate. But whereas, you know, this European Commission had sort of come in talking about a geopolitical commission, that agenda for the time being is off the map, unfortunately.
So we've seen a major provocation to a geopolitical Europe with events in Belarus in the last few days. You know, one of the areas least contested in global governance is international aviation safety and cooperation. And yet we saw a major violation of it with the government of Belarus interfering in the overflight of its territory by an airplane registered in a European country, flying from one EU country to another EU country, and forcibly removing a dissident from the airplane. Richard, this seems to me a major challenge to one of the most effective areas of global governance. How big a problem do you think it is, and what do you think should be done, especially by the advocates of greater global governance?
Yeah, Corey, you put your finger on a really interesting thing here. Global governance has tended historically to do best in areas that you would describe as quote unquote technical rather than political. So certain communications areas, aviation is a perfect example. Everybody has an interest in air traffic controllers, speaking a common language, having certain rules of the road and so forth. There's a codependency, if you will. And yet what we've now seen is the intrusion of politics and force into this. This is piracy. This is hijacking. Call it what you will, but again, it shows the vulnerability of even what we thought was the safe area, the apolitical area of global governance, to politics and sovereignty. In this case, an assertion of it by the government of Belarus. So, you know, the reaction thus far has essentially been in the realm of aviation. The problem with that is it's a limited response, and anyone could hop on a flight, I expect, from Belarus to Moscow, and then from Moscow fly anywhere else in the world. So it's an hour and a half inconvenience, is the sum total so far of the sanctions. I would think the only thing that would make sense would be to escalate their response. And one is through sanctions, not just of Belarus, but also Russia. And the question, with particularly with Russia, is do you want to do it given the full agenda that we have with Russia? This is simply one of 88 things that give us a real pause when it comes to Mr. Putin's behavior. So that, you know, there's that question. But other than that, you know, other than, if you will, isolation, greater sanctions against the benefactor of Belarus, conceivably think about ways of supporting the Belarus opposition. That's what this is really about. I don't have great answers for you. You know, again, there's not a mechanical answer to these things, to put it bluntly. It's not the idea that we could build a stronger convention against air piracy. The problem is what we have is an egregious violation of what conventions and rules we have. And the real question is our willingness and ability to inflict pain against the ability and willingness of others to endure pain. And right now I worry that the balance is on behalf of it favors the bad guys.
Nathalie, I'd love to know your reaction to that and whether you see a broader range of policy levers than Richard does for this case.
Yeah, I mean, I totally share the analysis here. I mean, but I think, you know, sort of the reason why the technical is becoming political is because I think we have already shifted in an international system where there is far greater normative contestation. And so in a sense, this kind of greater sense of impunity that authoritarian countries have and feel and exercise is because they are increasingly trying to assert the line of there's nothing wrong with our political systems. These are things that can be done. And I think it speaks to and about an international system, which in this respect is changing, which is why I sort of started off with, you know, sort of in my answer to your first question, Corey, talking about, you know, the way in which, in a sense, the sort of the world is becoming more normatively contested and values are coming back, in a sense, to playing a sort of far more prominent role in many respects in foreign policy and not just foreign policy. Now, having said that, the question, you know, the policy question that follows is, and therefore, what do we do about it? You know, what do liberal democracies do about this? And now, I don't have a great answer to the question, but I think that what is important is to reflect about the fact that the way in which we address it has to take into account the fact that the context has changed fundamentally. So we are no longer, in a sense, in that world in which we took for granted that there was one destination of travel. And so when, if you like, countries deviated from that single destination, then we could encourage them, coerce them in different ways, if you like. But ultimately, there was only one possible outcome, one possible sort of good outcome to the good life. Now we continue, obviously, you know, we as liberal democracies continue to think this way, but the point is that there are others that don't. And so how do we not only others that don't, but we also have segments within our own populations which are questioning those values, and hence the fragility of democracies, if you like, even within, if you like, the liberal West. So the sort of policy reflection from this is that, in a sense, the instruments and the methods that we used in the good old days of the international liberal order cannot be simply replicated in the same way. So yes, you know, it is still about sanctions, and it's still about, you know, is there a military component to this, and an economic component, and a diplomacy angle, but it has to be done in a sense in a different way, because the context has changed fundamentally. Now, what does this mean? You know, how do we avoid, in a sense, that our greater, in a sense, you know, having greater appreciation that we're living in a different context should not simply end up in pure cynicism and basically saying, well, you know, there are different political systems, and, you know, a bit, you know, in a sense, a la Chinese or a la Russian, and therefore everyone's entitled to do it their own way. You know, how do we respond when it comes to countries like Belarus, where very clearly the majority of the population would like to go in a different direction, a regime doesn't, and how do we respond in a way which is sensitive and responsive to that, but at the same time cognizant of the fact that we don't have, if you like, the same levers as we had in that historical moment where there was, where we all believed in a sense that there was a single destination of travel.
So, Richard, you talked about responsibilities in addition to rights internationally. And I think Nathalie was getting at that same issue. The challenge for global governance has always been who gets to set the rules and how do you enforce them? What I think I hear Nathalie saying is that who sets the rules is more contested now, and our ability to enforce them diminished, even as the values that underlie how Western countries would like to shape the order is becoming more pointed. That strikes me as a very dim prospect for the advance of global governance. Do you agree with that judgment? And what do we do about that?
We do not fundamentally disagree there. And again, the reason is that there is little, or in some cases, no international community. So to think that you can build norms, rules, and institutions in the absence of a political foundation or consensus is a fool's errand. You can't. So then what we're going to, but the corollary to that, and I think it's important, and I think all of us would agree on this, is the alternative to global governance is not an absence of governance. And then, so my view is we have to think about where is multilateral collective behavior possible? So it won't be global. The model, I believe, for the world cannot be the UN General Assembly. If that's the model, then we're really up the creek. Instead, the model has to be to build as much effective multilateral collective action as is possible. Hopefully over time you can build on it. So in some cases you have concert groups, in some cases you have coalitions of the willing, in some cases you have alliances, in some cases elements of a regional trade agreement are either emulated in other agreements or they spill over into the WTO. I think if you think of global governance, not as a switch, but as somehow as a process, ideally, we could build it, but given the backdrop that this entire conversation, and you brought it up, Corey, with Belarus, takes place at a moment 30 years after the end of the Cold War, where great power relations have deteriorated markedly in different ways, but still markedly with Russia and China, I believe we have to accept the fact that global governance as a universal collective enterprise right now, the prospects for it are extremely bad. But then what we have to do is where we can, with whom we can, build arrangements, multilateral arrangements that make sense. And then to me, part of the challenge is how do we, one way or another, influence the behaviors of the Russias, the Chinas, and other outliers to either stop disruptive behavior or to perhaps take on what we would consider to be more responsible behavior. And I think the more, for example, we could collectively build certain types of trading arrangements. One of the reasons I'm against the fact that the United States has not entered regional trading arrangements in Asia. I think it's a major, major mistake. Because if we were to band together with those countries and we said to China, hey, you want your goods to have access, here's the standard you have to meet about labor and about climate, that gives us a little bit of leverage. So I don't know if you call that global governance or not, but that's a way to move it in I think, in a constructive direction. So it's going to come from, from the ground up, if you will, from greater degrees of effective multilateralism rather than from the top down, that the world is going to meet, negotiate, innovate, and execute some new set of global machinery. I don't think it's going to work that way. This is not a 1945, 1946 moment. The balance of power is not so distributed that the victors in the war can do that. We may have had an opportunity. I'll go on for 30 more seconds, then I promise to stop. An interesting question for historians such as yourself is going to be whether we had such an opportunity and squandered it, whether we blew it 30 odd years ago after the end of the Cold War. Because one would have thought that ought to have been present at the creation 2.0. And I would simply say, there's not a lot to show for it. So I think now, 30 years on, we have to accept the fact that this is not a great present at the creation moment, given the distribution of power, the lack of common thinking, and that we have to find effective multilateralism where we can, rather than thinking about quote unquote global governance in most areas.
Nathalie, I see you shaking your head affirmatively. So please, before we go to questions, please add your perspective here.
Yeah, no, I totally share. And just to add a couple of points to what Rich was saying, I mean, I think that, if global governance is understood as something that is universal and highly institutionalized, then no. If by global governance we mean something which is potentially messier, which is made of different contact groups or different groupings, which really start from sort of the question of, you know, what is the policy question to be addressed? And then from there, kind of, you know, build the coalition of actors which is necessary to address it, then, you know, sort of perhaps in a rather fragmented way, but solutions and multilateral solutions can be found. A final consideration that I wanted to add to this is that there are, in some policy areas, at least, there is an element of potential sequencing here. I mean, if we take, climate this year, in fact, one can make the argument that you start building a consensus amongst the like-minded on whatever, climate finance in the G7. This then transits towards a broader setting like the G20, and it then finally ends up in COP26. Ideally, in a sense, this is, you know, I think as liberal democracies, this is the way we should be trying to think about it. I mean, there will be areas where as liberal democracies will simply not be able to find agreement with others. There may be areas where that agreement is necessary, otherwise solutions cannot be found. But in those areas, it would probably be wiser to try and agree amongst ourselves. And then once that agreement is crystallized, to try and push it forward in in formats which are, you know, where quantity in a sense starts trumping quality, if you see what I mean, yeah? Up until getting to the sort of more universal membership a la COP26 to stick to the climate example.
Can I say one thing on that, Corey? 30 seconds, I know you want to open it up. I think what Nathalie said is a really interesting example of a kind of incrementalist approach, but we're going to have to then accept or deal with rather the challenge of the outliers. And the question is whether it's an India that may lack certain means or a China that's more focused on economic growth and responsible economic behavior. So what though the advocates of global governance then have to think about, or what are the tools you would use to influence behavior? Might it be, for example, technology transfer of green technology on terms that countries could afford it? That's one sort of thing, the kind of thing we did with HIV/AIDS drugs. You make some mechanism for certain things to be available. Is it shaming of a country that can afford to do things responsibly and doesn't, like a China? Is it an example of denial of market access? Do we have carbon taxes and climate-related barriers to access? So if you're serious about global governance, where there is a sense of norms, what you really then have to ask yourself is, how are we going to change national performance? Because what really matters is that, rather than at some point thinking about the global institution, this is still a world in which national performance counts for most, and we have to be willing and able to address that.
I love the momentum of this conversation, but I want to invite our members to join into the conversation with their questions. A reminder that this meeting is on the record, and the operator will remind you how to join the question queue.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you're called on, accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. To view the roster of participants registered for this meeting, please click on the link in your Zoom chat box. We'll take our first question from Esther Brimmer.
Good morning. Thank you so much for such a stimulating conversation. It's great to see all of you, and I'm delighted to be part of this conversation. In the conversation this morning, we've talked about different areas, including technical areas and global governance and public health. I'd like to ask about a different area, particularly telecommunications and information technology. These are the new technologies that are changing how we work. This very meeting is an example, but this is also an area which also touches on values such as free speech and privacy. It's also an area where there needs to be much greater discussion amongst the liberal democracies, particularly in the transatlantic community and the US-EU conversation in this area. Could you comment on global governance and information technology? Thank you.
Nathalie, why don't you start us?
Yeah, well, I think, Esther, this is one of the areas. I mean, you know, if one sort of takes this, the broader question as basically what I'm saying, you know, which are the policy areas where a convergence of values is more important than casting the net as wide as possible? And where instead does the reverse, if you like, reasoning apply? I think that tech and digital definitely fall into that first category. I mean, it's to me becoming increasingly clear that this is really an area where there has to be a degree of like-mindedness, if you like, on values before one tries to enlarge, if you like, membership. So I think, you know, this really kind of boils down to the fact that in the transatlantic community there, and I, you know, to an extent, I think that there has been, you know, quite a bit of progress. I mean, this really used to be an area where we were, in many respects, sort of fairly far apart. I think that largely because, you know, largely as a consequence of how the world has been changing, I think that there has been significant movement on both sides of the Atlantic in a way which has actually created greater convergence. To the extent that I think on the, if you like, one end of the debate, which is basically the sort of the privacy debate, I think in many respects, the United States has come slightly closer to a more European, if you like, view, given the greater appreciation, if you like, of the security risks of simply sort of unlimited freedom. So that's on the one hand, whereas I think that Europeans, particularly over the course of the pandemic, are far less starry-eyed, if you like, about opening up to different technological solutions. I mean, you know, just look at the way in which the debate in Europe on tech has hardened vis-a-vis China, for example. So, I mean, I you know, to try and also find some positive spin to this conversation, which has tended to be kind of, you know, rather pessimistic, I definitely see this as an area where, firstly, I would say that, if you like, values, you know, sort of, as I said, you know, the values trump quantity, if you like, quality trumps quantity. And to sort of look at the positive, I think that there has been movement on both ends, if you like, in the transatlantic community to actually get to greater convergence in some of these themes.
Richard, does it look the same to you?
I agree with the idea that we need to build up from the bottom up with those who might be like-minded. I think this is going to be stunningly tough. indeed, when I look at the world, and if I have to think of domains, this whole area of not just telecommunications, because it's almost an inadequate word now, but cyber is probably the gap is largest between the technology and the degree of regulation. And in part, you've got fundamental differences about ideas and free movement and so forth. We may see it as a virtue, others see it as a threat. You've got regulatory issues with, and the question of how you involve these large companies that have an enormous role. It's not just a governmental challenge. You've got the question of what constitutes legitimate free speech, and what at what point does it cross over as political interference in the political processes of other countries. You've got espionage, some forms of which, shall we say, are accepted, and other forms of which, such as economic espionage, are not, at least by ourselves. We have more offensive actions. This is a question of the militarization of cyber. Indeed, cyber has the potential to be a weapon of mass destruction, depending upon against what it is targeted. And I think, and there's so many players, attribution is difficult. I don't know, Corey, when I look at this, I find this probably intellectually the single most difficult challenge in some ways in the field. It's not just building political support for what we want to do. I actually think designing an international set of rules and norms, and then we can think about institutions in this area. It's actually where our field, I would argue, has come up short. And it might be that there's so few people in our field who actually understand the technology and have a background in international relations. And what some have called regime theory. But I actually think that the ideas are not adequate. And not surprisingly, the politics and the institutions are woefully inadequate. But for anyone young who's watching this, this is a really good area to invest in and get smart on. Because you're gonna, if you're good at this, you're gonna be gainfully employed for about the next 50 years.
Next question, please.
We'll take our next question from Mark Lagan.
Hi there. I'm Chief Policy Officer at Friends of the Global Fight Against AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria, but my question's about democratic governance and human rights. It picks up on Corey's discussion of Belarus and then also the question we just had on IT. Obviously, right now, there's a serious problem about human rights, impunity, and issues of governance. Within countries, what do you think about the structure of global governance to deal with human rights per se? And President Biden has suggested bringing together the democracies of the world. What is the importance, salience, uselessness in your mind of an amalgam of the democracies working on these issues? Internally in countries. Thanks.
Richard, why don't you take the first swing at that?
Okay. Look, the first half of Mark's question was about what's on paper, essentially. I think a lot of the rules on human rights, opposition to genocide, even responsibility to protect are fine. The problem is the lack, in some cases, absence of enforcement or implementation. And this is one of the areas where very quickly global governance types run up against sovereignty types. And that countries say, yeah, that's all well in principle, but it's kind of like NIMBY, not in my backyard, not when it applies to me. So there's just a problem in translating norms into, again, in enforcement or behavior. My enthusiasm for groups of democracies is finite, particularly at this time. One is most global governance issues, in many cases, are going to require non-democracies to participate. Charlie Kupchan and I just wrote a piece for Foreign Affairs about calling for an international concert, a modern day one. And part of the argument is that values-based global governance in many areas is an inadequate formula for it. So I wonder a little bit about that. Second of all, how do I put this? Before the United States starts calling the world's democracies together, we need to get our own house in order. American democracy has to be something that is functioning and that has as something that others will respect and want to emulate. So my advice to the administration would be to put this on the back burner until such a time that American democracy, again, is what you might call that shining city on a hill. We ain't there now. I hope it's a question of when and not if we get there. But I would, you know, to use one of my favorite phrases, foreign policy begins at home in this case. Let's address what could be the biggest single threat to American national security, which is the dysfunctionality of our own ability to govern ourselves.
Nathalie, anything on human rights and global governance or on America as a threat to the global order?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think, let me put it this way, it's a three reflections. I mean, sort of the first is, in a sense, what is positive about the current moment, I mean, literally really quite recent, is that democracy and human rights are back as being an important theme in foreign policy. I mean, you know, I think that for basically sort of, you know, beginning with the Arab uprisings and sort of ending with Trump, there was a sort of long moment in which we kind of didn't really talk about democracy and human rights anymore. I mean, either because we didn't really like the results of elections or because the world was becoming a big, bad and ugly place. And so we just simply had to toughen up rather than just kind of, you know, worry about this, you know, these soft issues. But there was a moment in which the democracy and human rights piece simply kind of exited the scene. Now, I think what's positive now is that it's re-entering the scene. But as I was mentioning earlier, the point is that we can't do it in exactly the way we used to do it in the good old days of democratization and democracy promotion, if you like. That moment has passed. So I think, in a sense, today we're far more in a mode of not simply which connects to the US point, but even it's as much a European point. We're not only in the world in which, you know, how do we promote these values, but it's as much, if not even more, how do we protect them at home, and therefore how do we live up to them at home. Now, these two things, which is then connected to this whole point about, you know, the sort of alliance of democracies, could be seen as a source of weakness. I mean, it could be seen as, in a sense, I think it was slightly the direction that Mitch was taking now. I mean, yeah, let's first put our house in order before thinking about what other countries, about getting democracies together so that we can, in a sense, lead by example. And I think there's a certain sort of power to that argument. But one could also put it in a different way of basically saying, well, democracy is a journey and we're all on this journey. We can go forwards, we can go backwards. This is about, in a sense, you know, sort of sharing experiences and ensuring that we do learn from one another and move forward together if we have those ideals. Now, this, I think, helps us or could potentially help us also navigate, I think, a real risk that we're running with democracy and human rights being back, in a sense, on the agenda. And the risk is basically, you know, in this confrontation, particularly with China, but also with Russia and more generally with authoritarian states, how do we deal with the so what I would define as the gray zone? So how do we deal with those countries that are nominally democracies, but very clearly moving in a different direction? You know, how do we deal globally with the Indias of this world or the Turkeys, regionally speaking, of this world? Are we, you know, if we go for the sort of black and white democracy, non-democracy, then very obviously we would either have to sort of cynically include them and therefore debase basically what values are all about, or we would have to be more coherent and exclude them, in which case we would be simply pushing them, if you like, in the quote unquote other camp. As opposed to sort of articulating this as a journey, which can go forwards and can go backwards, and therefore that we are in this basically all together.
Can I say, Tori, I think Natalie's a really good point. I remember in government, this question of who to include is a really is a problematic one, the gray zone, as she calls it, the Hungaries, the Polands, the Turkeys, what have you. But I also think there's a problem with what you might call the black and white zone, and that's, say, the Chinas and the Russians. There we have Hong Kong in China, we have Xinjiang, we have Navalny and what's going on in Russia. The question then is, where does democracy fit in America, in foreign policy? And I would say we're not going to settle that today. But it, since this is a conference about global governance, I think we have to ask, where does that fit? To what extent is that a step or a box that has to be checked? Or do we basically say in some areas, like as we did with Russia a few months ago, we want to sign a New START extension agreement? And the fact that they are arresting, killing oppositionists is something that we can't allow to preclude the other simply because it's essential in its own right. And so part of my problem with the emphasis on human rights and democracy, it's that we have, you know, we have limited influence in certain circumstances and that we there's real trade-offs. And so before we make it a central theme, we had better think through exactly what does it mean to highlight it? And are we really prepared to see it through?
I also think we have probably given too little thought to how international institutions can be used in a damaging way against free societies. Nathalie raised the point about protection. And it was to me shocking that we allowed a Chinese head of Interpol, given the way authoritarian countries are using Interpol red cards to terrorize dissidents and free voices. And it occurs to me that we have an assumption that we have the ability to control the actions of international institutions in which we are participating, and that perhaps we should explore a little bit more the possibility of them being used as weapons against us, which we have traditionally not thought about. We have 8 minutes and two more questions in the queue, so I'd like to go to the next of them, please.
Take our next question from Jeffrey Rosen.
Thank you. Unmute. Yep, unmuted. Interesting discussion, very interesting points. I'd like to come back to the point that Richard made a couple of moments ago about a foreign policy beginning at home and dealing with the challenges of our own democracy first. The question is this: the world won't stand still while we do. So what do you do? How do you proceed in parallel to both address the types of issues you've been discussing today, governance and so forth, and at the same time deal with the problems at home?
It's an excellent question. Nathalie, I think I'll give you the first shot at this.
I would put it this way. I mean, in a sense, you know, that the answer, for instance, that the Biden administration has been giving to that question is, you know, you have a foreign policy for the middle class. And the European variant of this basically goes in the direction of we need to work on our own autonomy. So basically, I mean, sort of developing our autonomy is essentially the sort of European way of saying, you know, we need to kind of think about ourselves first, in a sense, sort of couched in European terms. I think, in a sense, there's obviously value to that approach because, of course, if you don't do it, well, you know where you're going to end up in terms of domestic politics. And so we've kind of had a sense of that in that decade of nationalist populism, if you like, which then in Europe had also the Eurosceptic, if you like, side of things. So we know what it leads to if we don't do it. And yet at the same time, we have to bear in mind what it does lead to if we do it, which is obviously the risk of protection, I mean, depending on the policy area, but kind of protectionism, closure, you know, be it trade protectionism, be it closure to migration, be it, you know, sort of straining transatlantic ties in terms of security. So there are various risks, if you like, to pursuing something which in a sort of US version and a European version, in a sense, have to be done. Otherwise, the political consequences are far too dire. But there's a balancing act, in a sense, there to be found.
Richard.
Well, thank you, Jeffrey. Look, it's a thoughtful question. The good news is that in some areas, there's considerable, it's good news if you agree with the thrust of the policy. The executive branch in the United States enjoys considerable latitude and discretion when it comes to foreign policy, far more than it enjoys with domestic legislation, which is much more of a legislative, congressionally influenced process. So while we are sorting out things at home in certain areas, the president can still conduct an awful lot of foreign policy as he wishes. But that said, I don't challenge your basic point that our ability to promote democracy will obviously be affected by what happens here at home. Those areas which do have large legislative dimensions, such as trade policy, immigration policy, there the president's hands will be tied. And there's one other which affects, in a sense, the country Natalie comes from, which is American continuity and predictability. For most of the last three quarters of a century, when we had rotations in power, one, they were automatic, and two, the differences, even between the most ardent Republicans and the most ardent Democrats, was fairly limited, say within, I don't know what, the 35-yard lines on the around midfield. To the extent now that rotations in power in the United States are to, one, be disputed, and two, could lead to dramatic changes in America's relationship with the world, that actually works against our ability to influence the world dramatically, and as much as anything is a threat to the subject today, which is global governance.
I think we can squeeze this last question in. Please do.
We'll take our next question from Kilaparti Ramakrishna.
Thank you very much for taking my question. It's a fascinating discussion, although a little bit dispiriting. I thought with the pandemic in the rearview mirror, at least in this country and in a few other countries, it's time to really think about what had gone wrong and how to fix the global governance system, not just global governance, but the national governance system as well. But the message that I get is that, well, it was bad before and it is bad now. Am I reading that right? Or is there any prospect for doing what needs to be done globally and not have a repeat of this in the future? Thank you.
Richard.
Well, as the apostle of dispiritedness here, look, I mean, you're right in your take, at least I won't speak for my two colleagues here, but yeah, things were pretty bad before and they are pretty bad now, but there's nothing inevitable about what they'll be tomorrow. That's the dynamic of history. There's very little that's inevitable, very little that's baked into the cake. So the real question is there some collective learning? President Biden likes to say the United States is back. Well, we're not back yet, but maybe one day we will be. We could take a lead in doing certain things. We could create coalitions of the willing and like-minded. And maybe over time, if we did certain things, we then could create a system of incentives and disincentives where the outliers would begin to move in more responsible directions. So the takeaway from this should not be that better global machinery or governance is impossible. No, that's not the takeaway at all. We're just simply not there. We shouldn't assume it comes about automatically. And we ought to think really hard and really practically about how to narrow the gap between where we are and where we need to be. That's not meant to be dispiriting. It's meant simply to be realistic.
Dr. Tocci, you get the last word this morning.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Richard. I don't think that it's dispiriting. I mean, I think that, in fact, I think there is a greater realization now than there was just a couple of years ago that we need it, because otherwise we'll not be able to navigate those transnational challenges that we were referring to. I think that there is also a greater understanding that the way to achieve it is probably not going to be, as Richard was putting it, in that sort of highly institutionalized top-down way, but that we have to go about it pragmatically and sort of, you know, start from the different challenges, sort of start bottom up from the different policy areas and kind of see what works. So, you know, I think that there has been movement, if you like, both on the demand side and on at least an understanding of how the process on the supply side has to develop, which is in a sense puts us in a slightly better position than we were only a few years ago.
And on that note, I'd like to thank you for joining today's virtual meeting. And thank you to Dr. Richard Haass and Dr. Nathalie Tocci for this informative discussion. And the video and transcript of today's meeting are going to be posted on the CFR website in case there's anything you'd like to catch. Thank you, my friends, for joining in this conversation among the Council of Councils.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Corey Shockey.
Thank you, Corey.